all who eat this bread will never die.
Good morning, and welcome to today's service. This is the second Sunday after Epiphany, and it's also a communion service as well. So if you've picked up your communion elements from the office, we'd encourage you to have those ready for celebrating the Lord's Supper together with us during this service. Alternatively, if you happen to be watching this on Sunday morning before 9 o'clock, or actually before 10 o'clock, and would like to receive the Lord's Supper in person here in the parking lot, we're having a drive-through offering of the Lord's Supper between 9 and 10 o'clock Sunday morning. So you're welcome to come for that also. Let's calm our hearts then as we prepare to worship our Lord and Savior. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Our psalm this morning is Psalm 62. My soul finds rest in God alone. My salvation comes from Him. He alone is my rock and my salvation. He is my fortress. I will never be shaken. How long will you assault a man? Would all of you throw him down, this leaning wall, this tottering fence? They fully intend to topple him from his lofty place. They take delight in lies. With their mouths they bless, but in their hearts they curse. Find rest, O my soul, in God alone. My hope comes from Him. He alone is my rock and my salvation. He is my fortress. I will not be shaken. My salvation and my honor depend on God. He is my mighty rock, my refuge. Trust in Him at all times, O people. Pour out your hearts to Him, for God is our refuge. Low-born men are but a breath. The high-born are but a lie. If weighed on a balance, they are nothing. Together, they are only a breath. Do not trust in extortion or take pride in stolen goods. Though your riches increase, do not set your heart on them. One thing God has spoken, two things have I heard, that you, O God, are strong, and that you, O Lord, are loving. Surely you will reward each person according to what he has done. Our opening song is Tell Me the Story of Jesus.
Thank you.
Let us pray. Almighty God, to whom all hearts are open, all desires known, and from whom no secrets are hid, cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. If we say we have no sin, we deceive ourselves and the truth is not in us. But if we confess our sins, God, who is faithful and just, will forgive our sins and cleanse us from all unrighteousness. We take a moment for personal reflection as we prepare to confess our sins to our Father. Gracious and merciful God, we confess to you that we choose to walk in places far from your light. We neglect opportunities to do justice, to love kindness, and to walk humbly with you. We hide the light that is your gift to us. Forgive us and guide us in our way, that we may shine before others and give you the glory. Amen. In the mercy of Almighty God, Jesus Christ was given to die for us, and for his sake, God forgives us all our sins. To those who believe in Jesus Christ, he gives the power to become the children of God and bestows on them the Holy Spirit. May the Lord, who has begun this good work in us, bring it to completion in the day of our Lord Jesus Christ. Amen. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all. Our Old Testament scripture lesson is recorded in the book of Exodus, chapter 16, verses 1 through 5. As our theme for this service today is Jesus is the bread of life, which he himself says in John chapter 6, each of our lessons also describe bread. And of course, Exodus 16 describes for us the Lord providing manna for his people in the wilderness. Exodus 16, verse 1. The whole Israelite community set out from Elim and came to the desert of Sin, which is between Elim and Sinai, on the 15th day of the second month after they had come out of Egypt. In the desert, the whole community grumbled against Moses and Aaron. The Israelites said to them, "If only we had died by the Lord's hand in Egypt. There we sat around pots of meat and ate all the food we wanted. But you have brought us out into this desert to starve this entire assembly to death." Then the Lord said to Moses, "I will rain down bread from heaven for you. The people are to go out each day and gather enough for that day. In this way, I will test them and see whether they will follow my instructions. On the sixth day, they are to prepare what they bring in, and that is to be twice as much as they gather on the other days." This is the Old Testament lesson. The epistle is recorded in Hebrews chapter 10, the first seven verses. The author of Hebrews points to the sacrifice of Jesus Christ on the cross as the true bread that provides salvation for us. Hebrews chapter 10, verses 1 through 7. The law is only a shadow of the good things that are coming, not the realities themselves. For this reason, it can never, by the same sacrifices repeated endlessly year after year, make perfect those who draw near to worship. If it could, would they not have stopped being offered? For the worshipers would have been cleansed once for all and would no longer have felt guilty for their sins. But those sacrifices are an annual reminder of sins, because it is impossible for the blood of bulls and goats to take away sins. Therefore, when Christ came into the world, he said, sacrifice and offering you did not desire, but a body you prepared for me. With burnt offerings and sin offerings, you were not pleased. And then I said, here I am. It is written about me in the scroll, I have come to do your will, O God. And now our children's lesson from Megan.
Hello, children. Let's gather around for a message. On a mountain, old men went to see Jesus. Children went to see Jesus. Young men and women, mothers and fathers, went to see Jesus. Happy people, sad people, well people, sick people went to see Jesus. They wanted to hear what Jesus said. Jesus saw the people coming, so he went up to the side of a mountain. He sat down. Look at the birds, he said. Do they have barns? Where do they keep their food? No, God feeds them. And look at all the flowers. They do not work. They do not make clothes to wear. God dresses them in clothes more beautiful than a king's. You are more important than birds. You are more important than flowers. So do not worry. If God takes care of them, he will take care of you. Let's say a prayer. Merciful Lord, thank you for gathering us all here today. Help us walk closer to you this week until we can meet again. In Jesus' precious name I pray. Amen.
The Holy Gospel according to St. John, chapter 6, beginning in verse 25. When they found him on the other side of the lake, they asked him, Rabbi, when did you get here? Jesus answered, I tell you the truth, you are looking for me, not because you saw miraculous signs, but because you ate the loaves and had your fill. Do not work for food that spoils, but for food that endures to eternal life, which the Son of Man will give you. On him, God the Father has placed his seal of approval. Then they asked him, what must we do to do the works God requires? Jesus answered, the work of God is this, to believe in the one he has sent. So they asked him, what miraculous sign then will you give that we may see it and believe you? What will you do? Our forefathers ate the manna in the desert, as it is written, he gave them bread from heaven to eat. Jesus said to them, I tell you the truth. It is not Moses who has given you the bread from heaven, but it is my Father who gives you the true bread from heaven. For the bread of God is he who comes down from heaven and gives life to the world. Sir, they said, from now on, give us this bread. Then Jesus declared, I am the bread of life. He who comes to me will never go hungry, and he who believes in me will never be thirsty. But as I told you, you have seen me, and still you do not believe. All that the Father gives me will come to me, and whoever comes to me, I will never drive away. For I have come down from heaven, not to do my will, but to do the will of him who sent me. And this is the will of him who sent me, that I shall lose none of all that he has given me, but raise them up at the last day. For my Father's will is that everyone who looks to the Son and believes in him shall have eternal life, and I will raise him up at the last day. At this, the Jews began to grumble about him because he said, I am the bread that came down from heaven. They said, is this not Jesus, the son of Joseph, whose father and mother we know? How can he now say, I came down from heaven? Stop grumbling among yourselves, Jesus answered. No one can come to me unless the Father who sent me draws him, and I will raise him up at the last day. It is written in the prophets, they will all be taught by God. Everyone who listens to the Father and learns from him comes to me. No one who has seen the Father except the one who is from God. Only he has seen the Father. I tell you the truth, he who believes has everlasting life. I am the bread of life. Your forefathers ate the manna in the desert, yet they died. But here is the bread that comes down from heaven, which a man may eat and not die. I am the living bread that came down from heaven. If anyone eats of this bread, he will live forever. This bread is my flesh, which I will give for the life of the world. This is the gospel of our Lord. Grace be to you and peace from God our Father and from our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen. Let us pray. Father, may the words of my mouth and the meditation of our hearts be acceptable in your sight, O Lord, our strength and our Redeemer. Amen. I greet you in the name of our risen Lord and Savior. Good morning. We've been going through a series of messages. They are often referred to as the I am messages or words of Jesus, in which he refers to himself by a metaphor of various things here on this earth. 2 weeks ago, we looked at Jesus as the light. Jesus does refer to himself as the light, but we looked at that text from Matthew chapter 4, where Jesus is referred to as the light who is to come into the world, a light shining in the darkness. And even Isaiah chapter 9 is quoted as referencing the light of Jesus that he would bring into this world. So you could say that that message 2 weeks ago was about illumination. And then last Sunday, we looked at Jesus' words himself from John chapter 10, in which he refers to himself as a gate. That illustration or that metaphor Jesus is using to refer to himself as the access point through which one must come through him in order to access the Father. And we looked at the background into the ancient gates that existed in Jesus' day and even before him, that it was at that city gate where justice, perfect justice pictured in Jesus, was executed. Of course, when man executes justice, it's always less than perfect. But in Jesus, when he refers to himself as the gate, he is perfect justice, he is perfect righteousness. And this morning, we're looking at the scripture from John chapter 6, where Jesus says to people, I am the bread of life. It's not a common thing anymore for most people to bake their own bread. But when I was a boy, I can remember the smell of baking bread. In fact, if I think hard enough about it, I can conjure up in my memory just how I felt when I was 7 or 8 years old and my mom was baking bread in the kitchen. The smell of baking bread would fill the house. And there is nothing in this world like fresh bread that has just come from the oven. You slice it and it's still steaming hot. You put a few pads of butter on it and eat it just like that. You don't need any honey, you don't need any jam. Bread all by itself is without compare. Bread in Jesus' day is a little bit different from today. In Jesus' day, bread was the staple food of the people. It was transportable, it was easy to make, you just had a few ingredients that you had to put together. I remember when I was traveling in Israel more than 20 years ago with a tour group, we actually watched Bedouins cook bread on an open fire. They would invert a pot, a cooking pot, and then flatten out a piece of dough and cook it right on that cooking pot, flip it over and cook the other side. That's how they made bread. So it was flat. So it was transportable, easy to make. Just a little wheat flour, a little salt, a little water, and you had something to take you through the day. Of course, bread, and I'm well aware of this, being a diabetic, is full of carbohydrates. And that's what gives you energy. I have to kind of watch the intake of bread. Staple foods is an unknown quality or quantity to most Americans. We don't really have a staple food in the U.S. I guess if you really had to press it, we would say that the staple food of most Americans is pizza. It's about as close as you can get to a staple food in the U.S. But during the 20 years that Patty and I spent in Kenya, they most definitely have a staple food, and it's something called ugali. I remember the first time I was told the name of this food, Patty and I both kind of looked at each other and went, ooh, golly. And that's kind of how it tastes. It's cornmeal that is boiled in water until it's thick enough that you can't stir it anymore. You keep on adding and adding until it becomes even thicker than a paste. Something that you can grab with your hands, and then it would be made in a whole pot and then turned over in the middle of the table, and everyone would grab a handful. And they would eat vegetables, they would eat soups and stews. Instead of using utensils, most rural Kenyans at least would eat with their hands and use this ugali as a kind of scoop to eat their food. As I mentioned, Israel's staple food was bread. It was what people ate almost at every meal. So it is significant in John chapter 6, when Jesus is in a discussion with people who have followed him after the feeding of the 5,000, looking for him to supply this endless supply of bread, that Jesus would redirect them from the earthly physical bread to himself, and he calls himself the bread of life. That scripture is found in John chapter 6, which is our text for this morning, verse 48. Just those six words, I am the bread of life. I encourage you, if you have your Bibles with you, and there's something wrong if you don't have a Bible in your home, we can make sure you get one. Turn to John chapter 6, because we're going to be looking at various verses as background and context for this message from Jesus that he is the bread of life. If you look at the opening verses of John chapter 6, you'll notice that it is the feeding of the 5,000 by Jesus. And that name and even that number is a little bit misleading, because only the men were counted. So we can assume there were just as many women as there were men, so that's 10,000. And the average family would have at least three children. So you can really multiply this 5,000 times five, at the very least. So most likely on that hillside where Jesus fed the crowd, there were upwards of 25,000 people. This is what it might have looked like.
Behold the multitude. This is a desert place. And now the time's far past. Send them away that they may go into the villages and buy themselves bread. They have nothing to eat.
Give ye them to eat.
Shall we go and buy 200 penny worth of bread
I give them to eat. How many loaves have you?
5 and 2 fishes.
Bring them to me. Divide the people into companies of 50 that they might be fed. O Father, Lord of heaven and earth, I thank thee for thy bounties. Amen.
After the feeding of the 5,000, of course, Jesus asks his disciples to pick up all the pieces remaining, and they fill 12 baskets full, proving the point to the disciples that Jesus is the author of provision in excess. Then they get into a boat, Jesus and the disciples, and they go across the Sea of Galilee, really not all the way across, more about an angle from where they are near Tiberias, to the town of Capernaum, which was Jesus' hometown. The people, once they realize Jesus has left, search him out. And they get into boats also. That's recorded in verse 24. It says, once the crowd realized that neither Jesus nor his disciples were there, they got into the boats and went to Capernaum in search of Jesus. So picture in your mind this flotilla of boats, maybe even thousands of people in the various fishing boats that were along the shoreline, seeking out Jesus. Maybe they even see him off in the distance on the horizon in the middle of the lake headed for Capernaum. And once they reach Jesus, they have a conversation with him. And repeatedly, in that conversation that Jesus has with them, Jesus recognizes what their true need is. He also recognizes what their motivation is, why they have followed him. They weren't looking for a savior. They weren't looking for mercy and grace and forgiveness for sin. Jesus reveals their motivation. He says in verse 26, I tell you the truth, you are looking for me, not because you saw the miraculous signs, but because you ate your loaves and had your fill. So it wasn't a hunger of the heart, it was a hunger of the belly. That's where they were focused. And Jesus speaks a word of correction to them. I am not just the Lord of heaven and earth, the one who causes the ground to create wheat, and from that wheat is ground into a flour and it makes bread. That's not all I am. But that's all you want me to be. You are focused on the gift instead of the giver. That's Jesus' word of correction. In fact, he goes one step further in verse 27 and says, do not work for food that spoils, but for food that endures to eternal life, which the Son of Man will give you. And of course, that Son of Man is Jesus himself. As this conversation continues, again and again, Jesus refers to himself as the bread that has come down from heaven. Look at verse 33. For the bread of God is he who comes down from heaven and gives life to the world. Verse 35. I am the bread of life. He who comes to me will never grow hungry. Verse 41. At this, the Jews began to grumble about him because he said, I am the bread that came down from heaven. And then our text for today from verse 48, where Jesus outright says, I am the bread of life. And again in verse 51, I am the living bread that came down from heaven. So you would have to be a few bricks short of a wheelbarrow to not get Jesus' point as to what the true bread is that they should have been desiring. And instead of accepting Jesus at his word, they take offense. Now, there are some biblical scholars who say that the following analogy that Jesus uses, specifically talking about, unless you eat my flesh and drink my blood, you have no part with me, that is what confused and caused offense in the hearts of those who didn't accept him. But I don't think it was just confusion over that analogy. I think it was outright unbelief. They didn't want the bread that came down from heaven. They wanted the bread that spoils, and they wanted Jesus to provide it. I've even heard sermons in which the theme of the sermon is Jesus the bread king? Because that is precisely what these people wanted from Jesus and was the basis upon which they rejected him. That's a great temptation in our world today, to want Jesus to be less than what he is, to just be someone who provides for the material things of life, just wants him to be a bread king. And we are fooling ourselves if we think that priority or that perspective does not also find itself in the church. There's an interesting opinion writer, editorialist, I guess you'd call him, works for the New York Times. Back in 2018, in December 12th, if you want to look it up, the New York Times, December 12th, 2018, he wrote an opinion piece with great insight as to what's happening in the 21st century in the church. I'm going to jump into the middle of the article and you can read the whole thing for yourself. Just look it up on Google. It's written by a man by the name of Ross Douthat, D-O-U-T-H-A-T. Now you have all the information and you can look it up for yourself. But here's a portion of how he describes the church today. And I think it is sounding eerily like the same attitude that these people had in conversation with Jesus regarding the bread of life. A diminishing in one's mind of who Jesus is and who he came to be. He says, so perhaps instead of secularization, it makes sense to talk about the fragmentation and personalization of Christianity. To describe America as a nation of Christian heretics. This is the New York Times. In which traditional churches have been supplanted by self-help gurus and spiritual political entrepreneurs. These figures cobble together pieces of the old orthodoxies, take out the inconvenient bits, and pitch them to mass audiences that want part of the old-time religion, but nothing too unsettling or challenging or ascetic. Insightful, isn't he? He continues. The result is a nation where Protestant awakenings have given way to post-Protestant wokeness, where Reinhold Niebuhr and Fulton Sheen have ceded pulpits to Joel Osteen and Oprah Winfrey, where the prosperity gospel and Christian nationalism rule the right, and a social gospel denuded of theological content rules the left. I think Mr. Duthat is right on and has accurately described much of the church today. Of course, that's not United Lutheran Church. We accept Jesus for who he said he was. First and primarily, our Savior from sin. Yes, he also provides provision, but that is a secondary application from this text in which Jesus refers to himself as the bread of life. We find this same temptation to desire a God who takes care of my physical needs in the Old Testament as well, and in the New Testament. Otherwise, why would Paul, in his first letter to Timothy, warn that young pastor that the love of money is the root of all kinds of evil? And the primary example, I believe, in the Old Testament is a man by the name of Achan in Joshua chapter 7. If you're not familiar with that story, I encourage you to read it. When God's people took possession of the promised land, of course, you know the song about Jericho and how the people marched around that city. But one little known fact about the conquest of Jericho was that the Lord had made specific instructions to the army and to all of the people that everything in that city, all of the plunder, belonged to the Lord. And the people were not to keep even one piece of clothing. I think it has a lot to do with the fact that the Lord wants prime place in the hearts of his people. He's number one. So the very first city that they conquer belongs to the Lord. All of it. Everything inside of it. And they would express their willingness to accept that the Lord is first in my life by dedicating everything, all the plunder in that city, to the Lord. Of course, Achan and his pride and his greed got the best of him. And when he's found out in Joshua 7:21, he even admits, "When I saw in the plunder a beautiful robe from Babylonia, 200 shekels of silver and a wedge of gold, I coveted them and took them." This not only had deadly consequences for Achan, because the Lord commands that Achan should be stoned and then burned and then buried. That's how serious the Lord took this sin of Achan. It also had consequences for God's people. The first battle that they fought in taking the promised land after Jericho was in a city called Ai, and they lost. Partially because of Achan's sin. 3,000 men died in that battle in the Israelite army. Notice how one individual's sin had an impact on the entire nation. If 3,000 men died, that's 3,000 widows and probably 10,000 children who were without a father, all because one man's greed got the best of him, all because one man refused to allow the Lord to have prime place in his life. Now, to be clear, when Jesus says, "I am the bread of life," he isn't saying, "Don't be ambitious," or that it's sinful to be wealthy. He's not saying, "Don't earn money and don't use money." Not at all. But rather, he's warning us about the place that we give in our hearts to the physical things in our life. Be ever aware that that temptation is there for those things to supplant the Lord of heaven and earth. And that's why Jesus offers to all of these followers who had witnessed his miracle the true bread that they needed. And he offers that to us as well. It's a bread that satisfies. It's a bread that saves. One thing I know for sure, no matter how much money you earn or get by whatever means, you'll spend it. And once you spend it, it's gone. And you have to pursue more. Not so with the bread that came down from heaven. Once you have it forever. He is the bread that satisfies. This is the great need in the heart of man. Our natural need within us is for the spiritual things of life. And the devil recognizes that for a time, we can replace that true bread with cheap substitutes. And for a while, we may not even notice what's missing. We have filled that vacuum that God intended to be filled with Him with cheap substitutes. Now, there are a lot of people in this world who have made a lot of money and have discovered just how empty that is. I think it's good to hear their testimonies. People's names that are extremely familiar to us. And there were a number of videos that I watched in which those testimonies were given by very famous people about the transitory nature of the priority in the heart of man in search of things that pass away and how empty that can be. May this testimony from Johnny Cash speak to your heart about the dangers of choosing the wrong bread, because that's exactly what Johnny Cash did for a good part of his life. Pursued drugs and alcohol, and he was able to do that because he was famous and had a lot of money. But eventually, he realized just how empty those things left him. Listen to Johnny Cash.
To describe the hell of trying to stay alive under such conditions, strung out on amphetamines and barbiturates. You see, it's a vicious cycle. The amphetamines to get me up, the barbiturates to bring me down. And all in concert, when I started drinking in beer along with the amphetamines, I'd drink about 4 or 5 a night, but I got up to 12, 14, or a case a night. And I would take it to the concert with me. I want to get just about that high off the ground before I'd go on stage. Sometime I'd misjudge how high I was, you know? And I'd get on stage and I was a wreck.
The Grand Ole Opry banned you at one time, didn't it?
Well, I don't know how bad they wanted me in the first place, but the night I broke all the lights on the stage with the microphone stand, they said they couldn't use me anymore. So I left and used that as an excuse to really get wild and wound up in the hospital with my third time I broke my nose.
What was the absolute low point?
The absolute lowest point was just before the turnaround in 1967 when I was down near Chattanooga, Tennessee in my Jeep, and I decided that I could never face anybody again. I had gone back on my word with everybody so many times and hurt them and lied to them that I thought I'd just crawl off in a cave and die. And I find that every day that I make my daily commitment to Him and don't break that commitment, and the day works beautifully if I put my will and make His will be my will. You know, there are about one out of every 6 people, maybe one out of every 5 people, are prone to be chemically dependent. Something I learned in my hospitalization. 60 million prescriptions of Valium dispensed in 1984 in this country. You can figure 1 out of 6 or 10 million of those were dispensed to people who are prone to be chemically dependent. That means if they continue to take that, I'm not going down on Valium especially, but if they continue to take a mood-altering drug, they can become addicted or habituated to it. Valium or the sleeping pills or the uppers or the pain pills, and it can happen quite innocently that we can become habituated to these things. The problem with Christians, the problem with me as a Christian, was that the mood, the alteration of the mood, vexes the spirit of communication and worship and commitment to God. And it's like anything else that can become between you and God as an idol to take the place of God. It becomes a god to you. It vexes the spirit of worship and communication and devotion to God. And I just want to caution, since this is youth night, I wanted to caution the young people that are strong in the faith to stay strong in the faith. And if you don't ever have to try pain pills or tranquilizers or uppers, for God's sakes, please don't, because you can become dependent on them. And it's a road to ruin. From then, you see people sleeping under the bridges that have become addicted to drugs and alcohol. Everybody has to bottom out on it once they become addicted and habituated to it. I've heard people say that they felt so bad that they thought they were going to die. I remember a time during my hospitalization that I felt so bad I was afraid I was going to live. I didn't want to feel that way anymore. And I thank God for bringing me out of it and putting me back up on my feet and bringing me back to do the thing I love to do most of all, sing a gospel song for you.
As Christians, we can get distracted very easily from the true bread, even as Johnny Cash did. Those who listened to Jesus himself on that hillside, they ate the bread and the fish that Jesus provided. And how thankful they must have been, because it was the end of the day and they hadn't eaten. Yet they still fell into the temptation to love the gift more than the giver. Let us choose the food that satisfies, that endures and never spoils. Let us choose Jesus, the bread of life. Amen. May the peace of God, which passes all understanding, keep our hearts and minds in Christ Jesus. Amen. Our next song is I Bless Your Name.
Oh,
We confess our Christian faith according to the words of the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord. He was conceived by the power of the Holy Spirit and born of the Virgin Mary. He suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell. On the third day, he rose again. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Christian Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. We continue our service with the communion liturgy. In the night in which he was betrayed, our Lord Jesus took bread, gave thanks, broke it, and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat. This is my body, given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." Again, after supper, he took the cup, gave thanks, and gave it for all to drink, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood, shed for you and for all people for the forgiveness of sin. Do this in remembrance of me." You may now partake of the Lord's Supper. First, the wafer. This is the body of our Lord. Take and drink. This is the blood of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. May this strengthen you and preserve in you true faith to life everlasting. Amen. Peace be with you. Amen. We join together in the Lord's Prayer. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come. Thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Let us pray. Almighty God, you gave your Son both as a sacrifice for sin and a model of the godly life. Enable us to receive him always with thanksgiving, and to conform our lives to his, through the same Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. May the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord make his face shine upon you and be gracious to you. May the Lord look upon you with his favor and give you peace. Amen. Our closing song is Refiner's Fire.
Let me be the same.
worked out when I handled it all on my own. And each time I failed, it made me feel twice as alone. In childlike faith, I gave in and gave him a try. And I came to believe in a power